We run uncut, so it's not
like uncut.
A clippy thing.
It's not a clip. I like
uncut.
It is uncut. It is the most, it's the least Jewish event ever. You guys have been around for now a lifetime.
Centuries, right? Hundreds of years. Yeah.
We started 100 years ago, and we have great doctors.
Really good surgery. But I mean, did you guys meet at school? Is that how this all began?
Yeah, met at film school. Like, I think I arrived, like, Labor Day weekend in 1982. Mm-hmm. And I met Randy, like, 3 days later.
And we were at NYU at the graduate film program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So was Spike around yet, or was that...
You know, a few years after Spike, actually.
Yeah.
He was before us.
Yeah. So we're not that old.
Yeah. But we met literally like the first few days of school, and we worked together immediately. Like, you know, we were making films in that program, and, you know, I would be the DP on Fenton's film, and Fenton would be the DP on my film. Our thesis films, not that you asked, mine was about a drag queen who moves to New Jersey.
You're doing the same thing your whole career.
I know. And Fenton's was called Hi Mom, I've Gone to Outer Space. And it was about a kid who kind of loses his mind but goes to outer space and performs
brain surgery
on himself.
So we haven't revisited that yet. We just stuck with the drag queen thing.
Well, you're very good at it. I mean, did you...
Well, thank you.
Was it fiction at first? Was that what your expectations of yourselves would be? Or?
It was fiction, I suppose. But well, actually, the whole reason we went to film school was... after we met, we thought that we would start a band. And... Oh, yes, so the plan was, because you know, Hollywood was very different then, and film school was, it was difficult to get into, it was very expensive, and then Hollywood was impossible to break into. Yes. So our plan was we'd start a band, have these pop hits, and use that money to fund our feature films. Mm-hmm. The small detail but was we missed, the small miscalculation was that we never had any hits.
Yes.
So we actually did have a hit. 25 years later.
Yeah. Mm.
But it was too late by then.
We were quite famous for being failed as a pop band.
Mm.
Mm. Because people like to tease you, or because it was...
Well, just
because
we never really had any success. But but we never stopped. And no, it was... But failure is a great way to grow.
Mm. Indeed. I don't learn anything from winning, I guess. Not or do really. You? Because you guys have been winning for a long time, so...
No, losing is the new winning.
Losing is new winning. That's what we say in Drag Race. But the other thing is, of course, that I think what attracted us to Unscripted was Manhattan Cable.
Yes.
Was the public access channels that we would watch, and it would just be these crazy shows, you know. Not just Robin Budd, who was great with her crocheted bikini and Bang Your Box, but then there were these... Just these crazy shows, like that were homemade, and I think that really—I mean, in a way, it was very punk, and I suppose also now, in a way, that's sort of what viral videos are. But you know, it was such an incredible sort of mine of creative stuff. We actually had a public access show for a while called Flaunt It TV.
Mm-hmm. Was that guy who had the art show? I guess who was hooked up with? He did a documentary about it called Plus One.
Oh, did he?
With, what's her name? The great artist, the female artist who took Cindy Sherman. Because Cindy Sherman's boyfriend had some sort of art show on cable access in New York and became famous for it, and then he became her boyfriend and then became only famous for that and kind of lost everything else because nobody cared about anything else. They just cared about the fame.
It's a tragic story, that is.
Yes. Yeah. So you did the Manhattan Cable film.
Well, we did it. It was a TV series.
It was a series.
And we packaged clips from all these different shows. We had our own show, Flaunt It TV, which we only did like 4 episodes of, because it was too much work. And
you still have them?
Yeah, they're somewhere.
Somewhere
in the archive. We had, Quentin Crisp was one of the guests. Zig Sputnik, yeah.
But anyway, we did that, but really, we were sort of part of, in the 80s, we were kind of part of the downtown scene. We always had daytime jobs,
But we left film school pretty quickly because we just felt like it was too much money and we would get too little out of it. And but like Fenton said, our obsession was Manhattan Public Access, and that's really what drew us to kind of, you know, reality documentary.
Yeah.
And our first big project was licensing clips from Manhattan Public Access, repackaging it, and putting it on British television. And that actually became like a hit in the UK. It was on Channel 4.
Yeah.
We just called it Manhattan Cable. Like, that was the name of the show.
So how did you guys get smart enough to do that?
It wasn't smart.
What do you mean?
We were not smart. We were busy trying to be busy being failed pop stars.
It was very time consuming.
It was very. And we were in London being
a lot of wax.
We're in London being failed pop stars, and there was nothing on television there. And we were like, oh my God, I wish we were back in New York watching Manhattan Cable. And that's literally. And then Fenton went and met with people at Channel 4 and said, you know, we got some clips and showed it.
See, that's
to
the smart
them.
Part. That's the part. Where
well, the, yes, the connection there was smart. No. That's the connection right. There was slightly. What is that? Oh, no, I can't even think of the word. When something's contorted,
twisted,
convoluted is the word I'm looking for. Slightly convoluted, but short story long. I was working. We both had day jobs, so I was working on Wall Street at Drexel Burnham, which was a high-yield bond investment bank, making training videos. I knew nothing about finance, but we're making these videos about this thing called junk bonds. Didn't really know what I was doing, but then I opened the New York Post one day, and this guy, Ivan Boesky, had been arrested for insider trading, and the whole investigation was focusing on the head of this investment bank, Michael Milken, who I happened to have been editing in my suite. So, again, short story long, made a documentary about him and junk bonds, and that's how we had the connection with Channel 4.
Yes, that's right.
And then they said, have you got anything else? And we're like, well, what about this?
Yeah.
And they were like, okay. So we went from high finance to Filthy the Dog, who was one of the great characters of Manhattan Cable, who was a dog called Filthy.
Yes.
And the song was, he's Filthy the Dog. Woof, I am so filthy, yeah, right?
That's right.
And it was like, it was just so fantastic because it made no sense and it had no purpose.
And Ugly George is still out there.
Yeah, he
somewhere
is.
Online, somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, those shows were just fantastic.
I'm old enough to remember that era myself. So that's Interludes After Midnight is the basis for
BBC. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Our favorite show was Voyeurvision.
Voyeurvision.
I've been with Lynn. You know where she'd be on the phone
and you get
talking
to call
live.
Her up and tell her to touch herself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she'd be like, I'm touching
it was
myself
some crazy
right
stuff.
Now.
So when did you get to the point where you thought, okay, we're documentarians, or
that only struck us a couple of months ago.
Yeah,
like that. Actually, I mean, really, that only struck us. I think making the Mapplethorpe film kind of thing. We were sort of trying to figure out what it was about. Why were we making a film about Mapplethorpe? You
really,
know?
It took that long for you to think of yourself.
In a way, because then Randy disagrees. We disagree about everything all the time. But in a way, because we're figuring out, yeah, he's an artist, and yes, he uses photography, but that doesn't really explain who he is. And then it was like, oh my gosh, he's a documentarian. And that's when I was like, yes, he's like us, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I suppose we did consider ourselves documentary filmmakers before then.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, I think we are documentary filmmakers. I think to some in the documentary community, we've always been outsiders.
Mm.
We are outsiders, and that's, we make our, most of our films are about outsiders.
Mm.
That's how, who we are, what we do, and even as documentary filmmakers, I think we're perceived as outsiders because we don't tick all the boxes of your traditional documentary filmmakers. Although that's shifted a lot in the last 5 or 10 years,
yeah,
you know, thankfully. So it's a bigger pool.
Yeah.
But I think we've always been more attracted to what's real, what's authentic, and so many of the things, and Mapplethorpe ticks a lot of those boxes. Mm-hmm. He was an outsider. He was incredibly authentic. He is a natural subject for us to be attracted to.
Though we didn't realize it.
Yeah.
Initially.
We did.
No, it's interesting. I mean, I think, I mean, for me, part of it is, I guess, your subjects have always been is the kind of subjects that would be exploitative in other films. Yeah. And yet you guys have found things about them that are not, you know, the Jerry Springer of it, or not what...
Well, I think I see it slightly different. I mean, I see it like that, but slightly differently, in that, like, Tammy Faye or Monica Lewinsky or Mapplethorpe, they have been exploited, no question about it, but it isn't as if they've really been revealed. You know, they've been the subject of headlines and gossip, but it's amazing how a lot of these overexposed characters, what's out there is the same thing again and again, and it doesn't actually go very deep. So they don't really go beneath the surface, and quickly just repeats, and the sort of the way they're covered is repetitive, and so very quickly just a very simple two-dimensional stereotype builds up that actually obscures the humanity of mm-hmm. these people. And so, I mean, in a way we didn't have to do very much to access what's underneath, because no one's really looking, which is the extraordinary
thing.
Nobody
really wants to, because it's easier and it's safer to treat these people as other than we, mm-hmm. when the reality is that it's what we have in common with these people. It's like that's what we should be looking for, because that's the way to making those connections. That's what humanity is about. So you know, there are these, you know, you go through life and people are separated into villains and heroes, and so often it's the people in the villain category that we just are attracted to, because we think that they're misunderstood and misrepresented.
Do you know when you start what you think?
No, not always. I mean,
sometimes. Say a lot of times we do. With Mapplethorpe, we did not. With Mapplethorpe was such a unique filmmaking experience for us, because we knew that we could defend making a film about him because of the artistry. But we weren't, like, for example, we didn't think, we thought we might not like him mm-hmm. for the longest time. Like actually, you know, the first year of making this film, we're like, we would be doing stuff and shooting stuff. I don't know if I like him. But by the end of the journey, we really came to like him a lot. Mm-hmm. So it was, that hasn't happened all the time. Yeah. Like, Tammy Faye we liked at the beginning.
Yeah. No. Yeah, Tammy Faye, we just knew from the out there was something different there, you know.
So had you met Tammy Faye?
Yes, we met her a few times. Funnily enough, we'd shot a show in our basement, like, at home, called TV Pizza. And we had on Tammy Faye as a guest, right? Uh-huh. And we also had on the same show Sister Paula, the transsexual televangelist from Seattle.
Yeah.
And that's we right. thought, whatever we do, we've got to keep them separate. You know, this would be very bad if they met. And of course, something fucked up and they met. Mm-hmm. And they just got on like a house on fire. Yeah. And that's when we realized we had Tammy Faye all wrong. Because all we knew about Tammy Faye was what we'd read. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people said when we started making the film, well, how long did it take before the facade cracked? And we're like, no, you don't understand. What you see with Tammy Faye is what you get. This is who Tammy Faye is. Mm-hmm. And she's an incredible person. She is sincere and authentic and warm and loving and funny and self-doubt. I mean, just all these amazing qualities. And kind of a drag queen, I suppose.
Yeah,
right?
Totally.
Well, the makeup was tattooed on. I mean, in a way, that symbolized the whole Tammy Faye experience, because it wasn't like you could take off the makeup and reveal the true Tammy Faye. Mm-hmm. The real Tammy Faye was there all along mm-hmm. in plain sight. It's just people didn't want to see it.
So how different was it making a film about somebody who's already gone?
It was harder.
Yeah.
But
did you ever meet, had either of you met him?
No,
we were around when he was, you know, towards
the end
of his...
We knew the name.
Yeah, towards the end of his life. And he was he was like a brand, you know? And mm-hmm. so we knew him as a brand. But we didn't know him personally. We knew we had a lot of mutual friends. But I think the beginning of the process, we really spent a lot of time trying to dig up. It became clear early on that he befriended lots of journalists.
Yeah.
And so we just hunted for for his voice, for, you know, and there were lots of sources out there. I mean, a lot of journalists had like a cassette tape in storage or whatever. So we were very lucky that people were helped us and retrieved audio tapes, and that was really the beginning of the process.
That's when we, yeah,
listening to his voice. The artist was present.
The artist was present. Yeah.
The artist and, was present.
And I think that's when we realized, so you know.
Well, that's kind of the theme of the movie, really.
Yes. And what was it like making a film about someone who was gone? In a way, the whole approach of the film was he's not gone. He's still around.
By design. I mean,
by design, by his design.
Yeah.
I mean, he was very, because he befriended writers, not because he was a big, he wasn't a big reader. He wasn't a big fan of writing per se, but he just wanted to be written about. He often didn't read what people wrote about him. All he cared about, as long as they wrote about him, that's all that mattered. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he befriended Susan Sontag, he befriended Ingrid Zichy, he befriended David Hershkovitz, Carol Squire. I mean, just, they're all writers. Mm. And he, I think in a way that's the other part of the picture. Because on the one hand, you know, Mapplethorpe, look at the pictures. But on the other hand, listen to his words, because he did all these interviews and left, because he wanted to be written about. So it's like, you know, pictures and words. It's really his film. Yeah, well, it's Mapplethorpe by Mapplethorpe.
Well, the film is not unclear about it. I mean, you guys, particularly in the last, you know, 10 minutes or so of the movie, are very clear about this being his, you know, how legacy-oriented he was.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That was really his whole thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Even, and then even when you think, you know, when you're watching the movie from the very beginning, you see the beginnings of it when there's a conversation about the ambition of him and Patti Smith. And, you know, the woman who can't come up with a word big enough
yeah.
to match their ambition. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of fascinating.
Yeah.
But and yeah. It's, but interestingly enough, like, those are some of the characteristics that make me like him, because mm-hmm. he was very open and honest about his ambition in a way, particularly yeah. in the context of the times. Like, then in the 70s, like, when, you know, art was about whitewater flux, and, you know, art, you know, stumbled on artists. Like, artists didn't sort of seek fame, or
they were discovered.
Discovered. They were like working, and but he was very open about his ambition and authentic about it. And I think that was really admirable and unusual. I mean, Warhol was doing it, but you know, they were the outsiders within, you know, the art community.
It does seem almost like the next step for Warhol.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, he didn't yes. call it a factory. He didn't make it quite as obvious. He didn't have other people uh-huh. do the work.
Right.
But he was doing a lot of that same.
Exactly.
Yes.
You know, it was very interesting. The other thing I thought was fascinating was the idea that, particularly when he was sick, that it had went, just bring in more stuff and shoot more stuff, that every one of those frames, you knew who it was from that frame. And the idea that, I always found it interesting that when artists have a signature that is not necessarily about a particular image or whatever, I mean, it wasn't about the bullwhip in the ass, it was about, there was a, something about the way he should shoot a flower, like he says in the movie, unlike anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And you see that, and mm-hmm. you see that there's something magical about him being behind that camera.
Yeah.
That was the, I mean, because that was the interesting thing in a way, that he was so articulate about what he was doing and honest. I mean, he tells you, yeah, I'm the only one who can shoot like this. And that's not a boast. It's, you know what? It's true, you know? Yeah.
I think one of the surprises, there were a couple surprises in making this film. One was like understanding or sort of appreciating him as a person, sort of discovering who he was and his humanity and then kind of liking it. But the other was really discovering him as an artist, because like we knew about his work a little bit, but it was so overshadowed by the Jesse Helms controversy that we really never kind of dove into his body of work and kind of looked at it from the beginning to the end. And it, you know, he's a pretty great artist, and had a very clear notion that he was an artist from a very young age and was producing work, you know, from day one, pretty much. And it's amazing. You know, we have almost 500 photographs in the film, so you really get a sense of his artistic trajectory, which for us was kind of, it was great to get to sort of really explore that.
So where are you guys as artists after all this? It's been 25 years you've been doing this, or a little more. Yeah. I mean, did you kind of almost act...
Well, you know, this isn't really an answer to your question, but in a way you didn't ask the question yet, but television is an art, and I think it's not recognized as such. And, we love it because, critics pile on about reality TV, and the New York Times can't insult the genre enough. But in fact, it is an art, and the people who work in it are artists. And it's actually nice to be able to work in that sphere because you don't get distracted by this crowd of poncy people, adding a sort of pompous dimension to what you're trying to do. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of one of my favorite bits in the Mapplethorpe film is when Robert Sherman and Ken Moody revisit the experience of shooting that ultra famous picture of the two heads, the black head with the eyes closed, the white head with the eyes open, mm-hmm. And critics have talked so much about it and have talked it up and these incredibly elaborate theories and art criticism. And they're like, no. He wasn't like that. He didn't, he just didn't care about that. He just put one in front of the other because I think that's similar to around the work that we do as artists, because no one considers it art. There aren't critics sort of looking at, I'm about to contradict myself now, because they, but in terms of people don't really look at Drag Race. I mean, it's not as a great work of art. Well, they do now, right?
They do.
Well, it took 8 seasons, damn it. You know what? And 100 episodes.
I don't want to contradict you.
You do. Right? You do all the time.
I don't think we have become comfortable not being perceived as artists because we just do what we do. And Mapplethorpe is an extension of what we've been doing for 25 years. And the film is we lose ourselves in it, in the subject, and the subject informs everything about the film, the aesthetic, the story, that's why if you look at say The Eyes of Tammy Faye or Monica in Black and White or Mapplethorpe, they're similar in their humanity, but different in their approach and their aesthetic, because we're all about completely immersing ourselves in the story and the subject and letting that inform the aesthetic. And I do think, we don't care if people think it's art or not.
But it is.
Well, I mean, it's funny, a lot of the way Mapplethorpe describes what he does and how he did it, kind of we can relate to. And I think, including our reality television work, which, is as important and is as immersive and special as our documentary.
Well, do they inform one another? Feel separate? Do they?
No, they're not separate. Because we're really screen agnostic. It doesn't matter. We say it's not the size of the screen, but it's the dimensions of the story that counts. So, some stories are better on a TV screen, some are better on a large screen, mm-hmm. but it doesn't matter what any old screen will do. I screen, you screen, we screen.
I mean, I think for us, it's always about, creating an authentic experience and being informed by the subjects. And, some things are a little heavier than other things. But,
well, but this 80 hours or 90 hours or 100 hours, whatever it is now of RuPaul, of Drag Race, mm-hmm. is that a different, it's a big chunk of your lives, a different aesthetic thing. You've been doing other things during it. Does that come to have its own weight that's different than just, quote unquote, making a TV show for you?
In some ways, yes. Mm. And in all fairness, there's a whole team of people who are artists, the people who work on that show, the showrunners, and there are everybody involved in it. I mean, now I'm contradicting myself, that show is a work of art. I don't care if anyone says it is or it doesn't, but it is. And RuPaul is an artist. The people who craft that show are artists. And that's the way we approach virtually everything we do. If it's not us, we've built a company called World of Wonder, and we're fortunate to fortunate enough to have all these amazing artists and filmmakers who work there. Big Frida, we do a show about Big Frida, an amazing artist. The show, you know, they're documentary filmmakers who are running those shows. So, you know, some of our reality work is more kind of straight reality work, but we really do try and bring our...
But even then, it's artistry. Because, yes, you know, like, yes. It's like a sonnet. You know, a sonnet has to have 14 lines, and this one's got to rhyme with that. Reality has certain conventions. Mm-hmm. And so within those conventions, you have to be creative. And it's really its own kind of poetry. You know, it's just different.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the era of iPhone photography and everything, people always say, you know, what's the difference between something on YouTube and something that's professional? And it's like, intention. Yeah. To me, it's like only intention. And then when you make a show, any show, really, it requires whatever level of, you know, everybody is working in a very real way. And uh-huh. whether it rises to art or not is really a post-production. You know, it's like once right. it's out there, mm-hmm. then you find out whether it's art.
Right. Mm-hmm. I suppose you find out whether it's art, but I suppose what Mapplethorpe did was like, he was determined that people would make sure it was recognized. He didn't leave it to chance. He wasn't like, I'm going to make the work and just put it out there. Mm-hmm. He was like, I'm going to make the work, and then I'm going to strategically make sure. And I think where we are right now in terms of his legacy, I mean, not just this documentary, but the books and the two retrospectives.
Yeah, it's like, the LACMA show, the Getty show.
He really, I mean, perhaps his strategy almost is better than the work itself, you know, because it elevated the work to such an incredible degree that, you know, curators respectfully handle with rubber gloves his Mineshaft membership card, this cheap piece of paper, this cheap card to this kind of incredible sex club, like reverently handling it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, that's pretty incredible. I mean, it's like, it's a bit like being able to get the soup can off the supermarket shelves and into the museum. It's a similar sort of act of, actually, I suppose, appropriate for a Catholic, transubstantiation, to transform this soup can or this cheap membership card into a piece of art.
Yeah. Well, amazing. Death helps also.
Death helps.
Yeah. I mean, death helps. Yes. All of our famous, our most famous people are all dead.
Yes, true. Uh-huh.
It's part of the game, I guess. But I mean, I assume that doing television and all that is more profitable for you guys. It funds your life in a way documentary really can't.
Yeah, I mean, there's a symbiotic relationship, and you know, one helps, you know, to spend 3 years on a documentary and that be the solo thing, it's a struggle that we're too old at this point. But also,
but it can potentially have a halo effect on the other work too.
Yes.
So it's like Mapplethorpe's sex pictures and his flower.
Yeah.
You look at the flower and then there's the would you look at the flower pictures if he didn't done the sex pictures? And I feel that
would
in a way
watch our reality shows if we didn't have our documentary.
There you go.
But the
pictures at the back of his head where the leather jacket has the pipe in.
Yes,
it was pointed out in the movie. I mean, that's the perfect example of that, where if it wasn't Mapplethorpe and it wasn't connected to everything else, you wouldn't make that analysis.
You wouldn't look at the picture twice, right? It's true.
And not to sound, I mean, altruistic, but I do think also part of the reason we do the other stuff, I mean, we have kind of built this really cool community of filmmakers and artists that we work with. And so it all sort of, part of it is feeding that. It's like we're growing it because it's like feeding our children.
So well, you guys are like one of the teams. Like there's the, you know, the Gibney team. There's the, you know,
Team Gibney.
Team Moore. Yes. Team who's the other one? Supersize Me.
Team Spurlock.
Team Spurlock. Yeah. And you guys have like your own
Titans.
We're with Team Spurlock.
Well, you're talking about moguls of the medium.
Well, it's interesting as these documentarians have come up, and it's such an isolating profession normally.
Yes.
Right.
There are a number of you who have now kind of built a little empire.
I do think that, you know, unscripted, it's a golden age of unscripted. And I think that, you know, from the moment Rennie and I had our own sort of conversion when we were watching Manhattan Cable, I mean, that was definitely unscripted. That's, mm-hmm. And we were like, oh my gosh, this may not be what people normally think of as documentary work, but we were like, this is a snapshot of life in the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And I do remember so clearly back in the day, documentaries were very serious, very dull, no one really wanted to watch them. And now they are this hot genre because, thanks, I think, to a technological revolution, the ability to enter that world, is, you know, anybody can do it. Anybody, you just pick up your iPhone, you can make a documentary. So suddenly, there's all these different ways of telling a story, a true story, and then there's all these different kinds of stories you can tell, both of which were traditionally excluded from the documentary world. So it really is this incredible, incredible time. And I always think truth is stranger than fiction. And I often go to the movies and think, this seems so fake.
Yes,
this seems so contrived. Yes. People don't act like this. People don't relate like this. People don't say things like this, talk like this. I mean, the whole thing is sort of ludicrous. And that can be enjoyable. But increasingly, I find the best scripted work actually is taking its cues from unscripted. You know, look at, you know, the O.J. series right now. I mean, it's great.
Or Modern Family.
Or Modern Family. Yeah. Or American Crime. I mean, these scripted series owe so much to the unscripted revolution.
I would just add two more things to your point, because also just how distribution has changed. And now we have streaming. Like, that has also contributed to this sort of golden age of documentary and unscripted. And I would just say, The other key factor is Sheila Nevins, because I remember 25 years ago having conversations with her about public access, about, like, you know, she was always interested in both in you know, not just in the earnest, like, how can I broaden what, you know, how can I broaden documentary and how can I sort of stay true to the earnest stuff, but also do the challenge material, do, you know, do the sex stuff. So she's always straddled the, you know, and straddles is the wrong word, because it makes it sound like one, it's like one's good and one isn't, that there's this judgment. But I think her, and not to put words in her mouth, but I do think she's always had like a 360 view of what unscripted should include. You know, and from all, because if you're really going to do to sort of be true to the idea of documentary, it should be high, low, uptown, downtown, you know, pretty and ugly.
And she's never stopped funding the stuff that doesn't get ratings. I mean, she's still got documentaries that are for a very small audience, and then, you know, Taxi Cab Confessions, which seems like actually Manhattan Cable
in a way,
comes to life. It seems like a perfect Uncle, you know, Ugly George show.
Yeah.
And the sex thing, since you brought it up, because of course that's what you did. But I mean, you guys are live in that world and have for most of your careers. Is that circumstance? Is it where you're interested in? Is it a function of being gay men? Is it a...
Well, I mean, you know, it's funny. I think the thing about sex is that, you know, we live in a very sexualized culture. There's no question about that. But what's interesting is no one ever seems to talk about it. Like, and the idea that you would take it seriously and consider it and think that ideas and concepts exist around sex and sexuality is almost forbidden. Pornography is not forbidden, but the idea of taking it seriously as a cultural force is forbidden.
Yes.
And that makes the least sense of all, when you think that without sex, none of us would even be here. So it's ridiculous that off the table is this thing that makes us who we are, this engine of who we are, and in its place, it seems, non-stop violence. And it's like, I've just never been that interested in violence. I don't like to watch it. I don't like to think about it. It's weird. But on the other hand, and yet if you talk about sex and sexuality, you're demonized, you're a pervert, it's all seen as very dangerous, and it just seems completely upside down, really. And in a way, perhaps that's why our society is as screwed up and as sort of filled with rage and hatred as it is, because there's no sort of fundamental honesty and openness about the thing that is most important in our lives, like sex and sexuality. It's really weird.
And so it's at the core of the hypocrisy of our culture. And I do think as gay men, and as gay men who grew up in the 70s and 80s where we had to come out, well, we were always out. Mm-hmm. We never were in. But that was, you know, that was different. Like, you know, it's so much different now than it was then. I mean, you really grew up being even more closeted and more potentially hypocritical about your sex and sexuality. So I think then you become very aware of how that is like at the core of our cultural hypocrisy.
I mean, if you're identified and then demonized and sort of separated out from society because of your sex and sexuality, you're bound to think about it quite a bit.
Yes.
I mean, you know, it's like, oh, what's wrong with me? That I'm, you know, like, on the considered somehow wrong. I mean, it's less now, but it's still very prevalent.
Well, the 80s
prevalent.
New York, you guys came up, was a pretty rough place. That was, the beginning of AIDS and all in the early 80s.
But at the same time, there was this incredible gay culture. And I mean, as much as public access influenced us, so too did, like, the Pyramid Club, where there were these amazing drag queen shows with Ethel Eichelberger and Taboo and
Happy Face and Lady Bunny.
I mean, that was, I think, definitely a lightning bolt for us. It was like, oh my God, this is an art form. This isn't about, you know, it's been said that drag is transphobic fancy dress. It's been said that it's misogynistic. It's not. That's completely untrue. What it is an art form. You know, it is using the body kind of as a canvas and creating art with that. Ephemeral art in the sense that, yes, at the end of the evening, you take it off, throw it away, it's gone, or it was made out of nothing in the first place. It wasn't an expensive production, but it is, it's kind of like living sculpture, really. Mm-hmm.
It's funny, and we, Fenton and I, discovered the pyramid by cutting our editing classes at NYU, and we would go to the happy hour, and that was like the beginning. That was truly the beginning.
It was,
because then we quit school and like we registered for the School of Drag.
We did,
at the Pyramid Club, and all of those people were and still are like they're to us. Those that's our Meryl Streep. Like, those people are superstars, and they still, you know, we're friends with many of them to this day.
What was the, our editing teacher was amazing, and he passed away, actually, of AIDS, didn't he? But what was the class that we skipped? Because it, was it Bunuel? And the floor tiles.
We walked
the black and white tiles, and we're like, it was like, there was this endless analysis of the black and white of the floor tiles, but what was the movie?
Forgetting. It was
something about.
We just looked at each other and we're like, let's go
get a gin and tonic. They were only a dollar, and it was basically just gin. I mean, like with a splash of tonic.
No, I mean, in a way that as gay culture has become more mainstream than in all of society, in some ways, I think straight sexual culture has become less so. In a weird way, even though clothes are tighter and tighter, there's the war between, you know, where the lines are, and the confusion of men trying to figure out where they, you know, what's a fair game, what's not, and women as well, is, you know, it's almost like we're in more of a closet as straight people, like we've gone into the closet in some strange way, and the gay culture is the only place you can actually show it. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't see a lot of movies about straight sexuality.
It's true.
Well, you see a lot of stuff about gay sexuality.
You do.
In a weird way.
Not enough.
Well, it's been reduced to, even on HBO, it's been reduced to, you know, a porn star talking about dildos or whatever, which is, you know, and Skinamax, as it were, which is not very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Right, it's not the total picture by any means. That's interesting.
No. Because because it is confusing out there, and a little scary, and everybody wants to be, the whole point is enjoying that.
And it's so weird, and yet at the same time, like, everything is so sexualized. It's like, it is, it's It's not, it's intense. It's so confusing. It is the big conflict of our culture because, like, everyone is at home Googling, you know, hardcore stuff. But sexuality is completely closeted.
Yeah. And when you think about, like, Inside Deep Throat, you think about that period and how it became a kind of public thing for a second and then had to be shut down by everybody. Yes. But it was like, it's an interesting, like, there's something nostalgic, weirdly, about, you know, the Seventh Avenue porn theater.
Yeah. Yes. There was that moment where it almost crossed over, where, like, suburban people were going to see porno films, you know, in the suburbs. And I think, I think part of the reason that it just, you know, obviously part of it is just, you know, conservative, the conservative movement kind of moving in and shutting things down. But also part of it is just about money and somehow commodifying sexuality in a different way, in a way that the, I don't know, because
what you're saying is the sexual revolution was originally a revolution of ideas.
Yes.
And then it became commodified and it became a business. And then it was like, okay, we can have it as a business because the American way is commerce and trade, but we cannot have it as a cultural force. And that was the sort of, that was the outcome of the sexual revolution, which in a way never really happened. I mean, a lot of people say it started to happen and then it got shut down. And from that point on, you had pornography, commerce, and
yes,
then
it was like Marky Mark in his underwear or whatever. It was
excluded
product
from the culture, you know.
Yeah. Well, the pill happened.
Yeah,
I mean, that's really the biggest change, I think.
Yes.
That was like the orientation for women.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been trying to figure it out ever since.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, we're still deeply confused.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As people
So we should spend some more time thinking about it.
Yeah.
You know, that's why we're just making a series for National Geographic Channel, 5-6-part series. About
sex
in the last 50, 60, sort of post World War II, really.
Mm. And your movie probably could not have been on HBO in 1985 or 86.
No.
I'm surprised it could be on HBO today.
The picture, certainly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That world has changed. I mean, so that tells you where we've gotten also.
Yeah.
We made some progress.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll see, right? Because we were convinced when we put it together that they would see the cut and we'd have to take some things out. So we put a few extra things in so we could trade. You know, we're like, okay, we'll take this one out.
But we didn't have to do that.
They didn't want us to take anything out.
Well, once you have the picture of Mapplethorpe looking back at the camera with a bullet in his ass, you can't really go anywhere. There's nowhere much further to go than that.
Right.
You could, like, white out the...
You could blur it out.
That would be obscene, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that would, because it would be like, what is this blotch doing on this brilliant picture?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, the craziest thing I've seen actually this year was on vinyl on HBO, where they have a wall of records in the records, I guess in the record studio or whatever, and they blurred them all out. Because apparently, I guess once they went to go clear the show with the network, they realized that all those things were copyrighted and couldn't get clearance on everything.
Oh, wow.
So, like, there's all the records almost in that show are blocked out.
That's crazy.
Like, I don't know if anybody else noticed it, but it's like just the blurred wall.
Yeah.
So ultimately, commerce wins.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
It's nice.